This is a joy and a great honor. As many of you know, in all that we've done, we look at technology and try to avoid the cliche and the BS. Jack Hidary is one that has actually done it. And you know this when you know he published with Springer. For those of you that don't know the game, Springer is the adult reading. Any Springer book out of Germany is heavy lifting, and you go there to like the supposition principle on page 3, 1 over the square root of 2, 0, plus 1 over the square root of 2, 1. You know, you're there. It's Dirac and the rest of it. It's like heavy math, quantum computing, Jack Hidary on AI. Jack, I think we're ready for you on a Monday morning. The cardinal impatience now is, when do we see the outcome of the AI capital investment? Do you have an X-axis? Do you have a calendar when this works?
Tom, good to see you and good to be with all of you today. This is going to be a key year for AI. Been a lot of promise, been a lot of hype. What's real? Where's the beef, as the commercial used to say? And I think what we're going to see is the rise and focus on B2B AI and on quantitative AI. The past 2 years, Tom and team, have been really about consumer-oriented AI, about prompts, about typing things and getting haikus and college essays for kids. It's been about language AI, which again has many interesting applications, mainly on cost cutting. So if you are Delta, if you're Hertz, if you're Hilton, you have tens of millions of dollars of customer service costs. You can cut those costs with language AI. But 80% of the GDP of our economy is actually not driven by language, but by mathematical relationships. If you want to be a chemicals company, Dow, Grace, others, if you're an energy company, if you're a drug company, Pfizer, Merck, Lilly, you are driven by chemicals, equations, molecules. If you're a financial institution, again, language might be helpful to make sure you're on top of the SEC filings, but at the core is numbers, quantitative financial equations. Again, that AI is now hitting us this year. So I think we're going to start seeing the beef this year, next year, as we start seeing B2B applications using quant AI, quantitative AI, LQMs, large quantitative models, versus just LLMs, large language models.
Jack, I'm wondering what you're hearing from the companies with whom you're working or might be working, what their level of engagement is like with this kind of technology or where it might be headed. I think we were kind of in a moment after the initial kind of fervor and frenzy about AI where a lot of companies thought we should get into this or do something with it. How much sophistication is there in C-suites across this country and around the world when it comes to how AI could be used practically by these companies?
It's a fundamental question. Over the past 24 months, we've literally been in the C-suites. They gather in large rooms at the top of their buildings. They invite folks like us in to give the AI talk and see what's going on. And initially, a lot of it was reflexive, to your point. A lot of it was, let's check the box as a company. Let's announce to our shareholders that we're doing something in AI. We've got an AI plan. But I think that that the bloom is off that rose. And I think now C-suites are getting more sophisticated. If you look at the drug companies as an example, their business model is one of the worst in the world. When you think about a drug company, it's a hit-based business. 90% fails, 10% succeeds. That 10%'s got to carry the 90% of failures. It's really not a great model at all because they don't have the predictive tools to figure out ahead of a clinical trial what is going to work and what's not going to work right for that therapeutic, for cancer, for Parkinson's, right, for Alzheimer's. The promise of AI and what's happening right now is that we're beginning to bend that curve. And so drug companies, as an example, are beginning to shift from the reflexive, oh, we're using AI, to now a serious look at the tools that can bend the curve of success and failure in the actual trial.
Jack, help me here with AI and the idea of making a profit or not and the fear that it will harm us. Like, are you walking around? I mean, folks, this is a guy who actually got through Schrodinger equations. Okay, some of us mere mortals didn't. Jack, just to cut to the chase, is AI an evil thing? There's that tone out there, that tinge out there.
Well, Tom, it's a great question. First of all, thanks for the shout out to the book, but also to Springer. I agree with you 100%. The day that I found out that Springer would publish the book, and again, many people in the audience may not yet have heard of Springer, the publisher, but it's the number one publisher in the technical and science areas, and they've done a great job. If people have trouble sleeping at night, Tom, the thing is to buy this book and make sure they get through two or three pages before they It's a math-heavy book. It's a technical book. And the reason why it's technical and has code in it, the reason why, is that this stuff has to be made real. The only way to make it real is to put it in terms of the code that you actually implement. So, but I appreciate that shout out. To your question, I think that, you know, the initial fear of existential doom and Terminator AI, honestly, what I'm more worried about is less Terminator AI and more teenage AI. Right now, some of the AI models are in their teenage years. Teenagers have this characteristic, I think, as we all know. They often appear to be mature and responsible young adults, but every few weeks they remind us that they're not when the car doesn't come back intact or things like that. And so that's where AI is today. And what the concern that I would have is that we're giving, in some cases, in some sectors, too much responsibility to AI to run mission-critical kinds of operations, when we should be using AI as analysis, as prediction, but not necessarily to run mission-critical stuff. But the bigger picture, Tom, to the macroeconomic picture, I know on this show, very often you like to dig into that, is that over the longer-term period, but now we're talking about a 10-year period, we're going to see a deflationary impact of AI, both the language AI, but even more so from the quantitative AI.
I got 30
seconds.
And
this could actually lead us, if I could, to one of the first periods of deflationary growth. We have to go back to 1870 in the United States to find a period of deflationary growth.
Jack, Tom? I'm out of time. I got to go study Schrodinger equations, and we'll have you back on. Jack Hidary with us this morning. We're out of time this morning, but you can't say
enough
about...
This is the second law? That was Newton's second law. Schrodinger. I can't remember.
The second... You're killing me
here.
No, I
don't
know. This is that quality Cornell education.
Yeah, I didn't go too close to the engineering quad. Tried to steer clear. Are you worried about AI? You're not worried about AI. No, you're curious about it.
I am not. I look at it like the railroads. And Jack was brilliant there, folks, going back to 1870. And I go back to Clay Christensen and Creative Destruction. And he was a huge supporter of what I did. And we tragically lost Clay Christensen way too early. We're dealing with selective destruction of what we know. And there's a legitimate fear. And people like Jack, who actually can bridge to the fancy math, those are important voices to get to, rather than some earnings call where, you know, great quarter, you know, what's AI going to do for you? That doesn't work. That's an inside joke, folks. David Guerin, Tom Keene, thank you for being with us.